Welcome to The VT Show, a weekly online series featuring Vineyard artists sharing conversation, insight, and performance. Please welcome Douglas Abel and Sarah Stern.
Hi, and welcome to The VT Show. I'm Sarah Stern.
And I'm Doug Abel.
And we are the Vineyard's artistic directors. We have a lot to cover in today's show, three decades of collaboration to cover, so we are going to jump right in.
Yeah, and our guests today are three amazing theater artists that we've had the great pleasure of working with through the years. They really don't need an introduction, but we'll introduce them anyway briefly. First of all, David Thompson, librettist, playwright, and two-time Tony nominee for Steel Pier and our own The Scottsboro Boys. He is also frequently known as Tom or Tommy, so don't get scared if you hear us calling him that, or confused, I should say. Susan Stroman, brilliant director choreographer, who is a five-time Tony Award winner. She's done such amazing work in the theater, from The Producers to Contact to Crazy for You and many shows with us. And then last but not least is this young composer we've just started working with. He's just starting out, but I hope you'll be nice to him. No, kidding. The immortal, wonderful John Kander, who in collaboration with the brilliant lyricist Fred Ebb created such incredible masterpieces, such groundbreaking works as Cabaret, Chicago, Kiss of the Spider Woman, and film work, including, of course, the famous theme from New York, New York. And we're thrilled to have them here.
They actually started their collaboration together more than three decades ago at the Vineyard on a show called Flora the Red Menace. And we have had the honor and the joy of collaborating with them on two more shows since, The Scottsboro Boys and The Beast in the Jungle. I don't know where that just... they are truly some of our favorite artists and people. And as Doug said, we are so excited to have them here today to talk about those shows and their collaboration. Please welcome to our virtual space, David Tommy Thompson, Susan Stroman, and John Kander.
Oh my gosh, we're all here.
Hey.
Hello. Well, beautiful.
Hello, hello.
Should we applaud each other?
Sure.
The immortal John Kander. We're applauding the immortal John Kander.
We are so happy to see all of you.
Thank you for having us. We're thrilled to be here.
How are you all doing? And tell us where you are.
Well, I'm in New Jersey. Outside is New Jersey, Milburn, New Jersey, and can't complain. You know, I'm in a house and have a view out the window. So there's no complaints. Stro, where are you?
I am hunkered down on 57th Street, and I haven't seen a human being for 65 days, but I'm fine, and I'm fine with that, I'm doing what I can, and happy to see some faces here today.
I'm up in the country.
Kander, where are you?
Between Kingston and Newport, in the middle of the woods. I sort of live here most of the time anyway, and I'm very happy to see my friends.
Well, and you have been friends and collaborators for, as we said, more than three decades, and so we have a lot of ground to cover today. Let's go back, first and foremost, to the very beginning. Can you talk about how you all met?
Strong, tell us.
I was in a Broadway show that lasted about a week on Broadway. It was called Musical Chairs. And I was lamenting with one of my fellow castmates about how I wanted to be on the other side of the table. I wanted to create for the theater as he did. And his name was Scott Ellis. And we were both talking about, wouldn't it be wonderful if we could do something and be more creative to direct and to choreograph. And Scott had done The Rink with Kander and Ebb, so he knew Kander and Ebb. And I had done the National Tour of Chicago. So I had met Kander and Ebb, but I did not know them as well, of course, as Scott did. And Scott came up with the idea that what if we went and knocked on Kander and Ebb's door and said, what if we took one of your shows, this, in this case, it was Flora the Red Menace, and took it off Broadway and did it in a whole new way. And, you know, the worst thing that Kander and Eb could say would be no. So we thought, let's give it a try. So we knocked on their door. And in fact, they said yes. And they were very excited about the possibility of doing that show again, but doing it in a new way, in the form of WPA Theater. And Scott called his good friend, who I had not met yet, David Thompson, Tommy Thompson. And Tommy started to write it. And we all went down to the Vineyard Theater to see Doug Abel and knocked on that door and said, hey, we have this show. Could we have a chance? Could we have one good break and try to do this show at the Vineyard Theater? Because it seemed, since we were doing it in the form of WPA, it was very, we went a more political route on it because it was about communists and such in New York City. And Doug seemed happy to let us try. So we did Flora the Red Menace at the Vineyard, and Scott Ellis and I never went back on stage again, because from that moment, it had a huge cult following. It was a wonderful, wonderful experience. And the thing that came out of it most of all was an incredible collaboration with Kander and Eb to then go on to create And the World Goes Round together and Steel Pier together. And Scott Ellis went on to create Curtains with them. And then I went on to create the Scottsboro Boys with them. But so from that, taking that chance of knocking on their door, we ended up not only with a great experience at starting out at the Vineyard, but a lasting friendship for all these decades, and the friendship now between the three of us, because we've gone on to do several things together, and it's been wonderful, and future things together. So that's how it all began.
And it was funny because it was absolutely terrifying. The idea of knocking on John and Fred's door at any moment, they should have said, you guys, we so nice of you to come by. No, you need to go home now. You're done. You're good. Come back later. But they were so excited to get to work. It was like we said, both John and Fred just said, and John, I don't know if you remember this, but you guys just both said, great. When can we get to work? And that was it. So it was remarkable. Kander, do you remember that meeting?
I also remember that. I don't remember Fred or me. Fred, or, I'm trying to do this grammatically. I don't Fred or me having any doubts about doing it. I remember. I think you spoke to Fred first, or Scott did, and I think we had our answer right there. I do want to say something about the production. When Hal Prince, who directed it, who produced it originally, and Liza Minnelli, who starred in it, came to see the production, Hal said, that's the way we should have done it in the first place. And and he was right. And I think that was a sort of little benediction over our collaboration.
Well, it was fun because we were in the old Vineyard, which was on 26th Street, and it was a community room in a building, and right, is that right, Doug? I'm right.
You could call it that.
But it was an incredible space because
it was a storage space.
Well, it was very intimate. But it was fun to work in because it was all about what you did on the stage. It was just about just rehearsing the show and putting it up, and the audiences were there. And it was sort of a great experience. I remember Fred saying to us, you're never, you know, he said, be very aware of what a wonderful experience this has been, because they're not always like this. And I remember thinking, oh, they're always going to be like this. But he was right. It was just such a bonding experience with the company, but also just an attempt, you know, the way John and Fred were so open to some, you know, just a lot of crazy ideas. We'd throw out an idea and they'd say, sure, let's try it. It was a good way to learn. It was a good way to learn.
I remember when I first walked you guys through our space, which really, it was very modest, a fun space, but very small. And I was also terribly nervous, John, that I was showing the great Kander and Eb are rather tiny space. And you were all excited, John. And we walked into the theater and Fred just said, where's the theater? Which He thought we were just in a hallway.
No, I remember that first look, and Fred said it, but I was feeling the same thing. It's around here somewhere.
but
I really came to love that space, and I really have to say this, and it's very sentimental, but from that day and down to this day, the Vineyard has been my home theater. And I just think of that automatically in my head. I've worked there an awful lot over the last years, and it just makes me so happy when I know I'm gonna walk in there, and that the next weeks will be exciting and creative and pleasant.
Wasn't that your first, for you and Fred, was that your first Off-Broadway show together?
Yes. I don't think there was anything else. No, I don't. No, that was it.
I recall when we had our first, what we call a meet and greet, the first day. And we were all of us were new and young and excited. But I think everybody noticed what was so interesting was you and Fred were so excited and nervous on the first day of rehearsal. And I think I just remember it so vividly that it was so moving to see that neither one of you were jaded about this experience, that it mattered to you. And it meant a lot to us too, as I recall.
I think Fred and I thought they're going to think we're the old guy. And so we'd better watch what we say.
I think to the stage, nothing makes us happier than when you are in the building, in the basement, working in that green room.
I'm happy from the moment I walk in that theater and start tripping down the stairs. Tripping being the operative word.
Yeah, but it was a fun project to work on, though, because I have to say what was nice about it was a lot of the stuff that we would ultimately go on to do always came back to that time period, you know, 1930, 1933, that period of time when so much was happening in the country. And it was great to take a piece and really explore that period of time. And then, of course, the score was so great, but then also to go back and look at songs that had been cut or needed to be reworked. And John and Fred wrote new songs. It was a great way to dive into a period of time, but mostly just to learn how to collaborate. I think that was actually the remarkable thing, is just how you collaborate. I remember Fred saying, you know, any idea is a good idea. We've got an idea, just put it out there. You know, there's no reason to worry about, even if you think it's a terrible idea. And Kander, what did he say that was a famous George Abbott, Mr. Abbott story about? Yeah, tell that story.
This is very important to me and to Fred. The first show we did actually was Flora the Red Menace, with George Abbott directing and Hal Prince producing. And I think that's where we learned whatever we learned about collaboration. We were out of town with Flora, and we would meet every morning before rehearsal and talk for a couple of hours. And Mr. Abbott made clear from the very beginning that what Fred had just told you, that any idea is a good idea. And there was never a clamp on your imagination. And we did lots of talking, and so we all felt comfortable with each other. And should I tell the story, the Fred story? It's pretty long. We had in one of our Monday morning meetings, Fred had an idea. And it was for a small change at the beginning of the second act. And it was an idea that didn't appeal to us very much, including me. And but he made a real case for it, and we talked about it a lot, all four of us. And then Mr. Abbott said, look, that we're here in Boston, and that's what we're here for, and we're going to put it in this afternoon. Fred, of course, became terrified at the moment because of this idea that he had, which nobody had supported with him on, was going to be done. And he started to back out. And Mr. Abbott went to him and said, now, look, we've all decided to do this. And we're going to put it in this afternoon because we've all decided to do it. And if it doesn't work, it's not your fault. It's all of us. And I thought that was brilliant. And it was like the key to collaboration for me that I've remembered forever. And Freddie did too. The collaboration, which is the key to musical theater, I'm convinced, has to be where everybody's voice is heard. Nobody is squashed. There are, it's not a competitive game. We're, as Mr. Abbott said, we've all decided to do this, and now we're all going to look at it. And it's, I think, for the three of us, it's what our life is like together. We talk and talk and talk and talk and talk and talk before when we're doing a new project, and everybody's voice is heard. And by the end of that talking, the three of us are all doing the same piece. It's an invaluable system. And then as you're putting it together and inventing it, again, that same thing, everybody's voice is important, and there is no vying for power or credit. Or I've seen that happen in other productions. I was a rehearsal pianist for a long time, and when that happens, it's disaster usually. And at any rate, the three of us love our way of working, and so we'll probably keep on doing this
forever.
Yeah.
No, but it was interesting. It was like a perfect time in my career, Stroman. I know you feel that same way, where you learned that even if you didn't necessarily trust your idea, you're asked to put it out on the table, and because it's going to lead you to something else, or it could be a truly terrible idea, but it could trigger something else. And that's always sort of been a safe feeling when you're in a collaboration, to know that you can, any idea, put it out there, and will everybody will hear it and listen to it or toss it away.
The magic phrase is what if.
Yeah, that's right.
What if she did this? What if Sally Bowles has an abortion? What if? And every what if has to be listened to. And it's fun. As a matter of fact, it's a joyous way of working. And I would never want to do it any other way.
Yeah. Yeah, definitely.
We have a little clip from Flora the Red Menace, an audio clip of our beautiful star, Vianne Cox, singing A Quiet Thing. And maybe we should take a listen to that.
Be perfect.
Just a little bit.
That was lovely. Well, I think it's time to introduce the star of that production. To quote the show, the kid herself. Please welcome Vianne Cox.
Hi, everybody.
Vianne.
Hi. Hi. Okay, I'm just trying not to cry.
And we didn't mention we had some surprise guests today.
Yeah.
But special guest with the amazing Vianne Cox.
Vianne, that was great.
Yeah.
Hi, Vianne.
Hi, Susan. Hey, Susan, I just want to let you know, just off topic, before we even begin, I go to my roof every night at 7 o'clock to do the tribute to all the essential workers, and I can see your apartment. I can see your your balcony. If you ever look out at 7 o'clock.
I'm out there.
Well, you should hear us on 48th Street. We have horns and bells and... Anyway, so yeah. I wave at you.
It's fantastic.
Hey, Vianne, I just wanted to mention in that lovely clip that we just heard, because he did mention being a rehearsal pianist as well, I believe the accompanist on that song was none other than Mr. John Kander.
It was. I will remember that day that we recorded it forever. A lot of it has to do with the fact that John was playing. It was wonderful. It was a simple single piano. It goes back to what you guys were talking about, how Hal Prince said this is the way we should have done it. You know, because it's this beautiful little gem of a show, and yet it's incredibly rich and fulfilling. But it didn't have to be a big Broadway show, and we didn't have to have a big orchestra. We had to have John Kander.
Well, just for that recording. At any rate, it's wonderful to see you. And when you said that you were trying to keep crying, you did a lot of crying in that show.
I think I did. Well, I mean, I think I did a lot of things in that show. there was a lot to be done in that show, and I think a lot of people do a lot of things in every show, obviously. But for me, I didn't know how to do anything. I literally did not know how to do anything. I did not go to college. I did not go to an acting studio. I literally just moved to New York. And that's all I knew. And I was a trained ballerina, but I had never really, I mean, I had had a few jobs in New York, like the Workshop of Smile that eventually went on to Broadway, and then I did some weird thing down at the Village Gate, but this was the first real show I had ever really been in. And my first story is that I remember sitting in the audience, and I don't know if any of you, not in the audience, on stage auditioning. I don't know if any of you remember this, but I told Scott Ellis not to cast me. I literally told him, I don't think you should cast me because I don't think I'm good enough for this part. I mean, I was terrified. Completely and utterly terrified to get that job because it seemed so important. And I told him not to cast me, but he did anyway.
You were incredible. I remember when you walked in, we had seen a lot of people, and I was always just looking for somebody who had the energy that goes with the story of somebody who has just arrived in New York and is determined to make it work no matter what. And I remember you came in, and there you were, and we all went, "Oh, that's Flora! That's Flora!" And it was an immediate response. And I remember thinking that was such a great moment. Yeah, and you were so great in it. And
you were so Peter Frechette also with your co-star Peter Frechette was so wonderful.
Well, this is another great story that I remember about the show is that I didn't know how to act either, just so you know. did not know how to do anything. And then all of a sudden I was put on stage with Peter Frechette, who I had to fall in love with. That was easy to do, okay? Because he's so beautiful and he comes, he's all heart and soul. And I didn't know, he taught me how to act just because I realized that you couldn't just do it once because, you know, you fall in love with somebody and you're like, well, that's easy. But then you have to do it 8 times a week for it to be theater. And so it taught me how to act. And I remember Fred Ebb came in one day and was like, how do you do that? How do you cry every night like that? And I told him, I said, well, if you had to fall in love with that him every night and he was going to leave you, you would cry too. I mean, it's a little more complicated than that, but for all intents and purposes, that was my training, everything. But okay, I just have to say one more thing. It's terrible. I'm just talking too much. But Susan, when you said that you never went back to the theater to be an actress, to be a performer, you, uh-oh, are you there? Can she hear me?
She's frozen.
Maybe she can't hear me.
Well, now then tell the story.
Well, you guys can tell her afterwards. She said that she never went back to being an actor.
Yeah.
After. And I almost, because of Flora the Red Menace, did not want to be an actor anymore because I fell in love with watching the show. I was like, I just want to be an audience member. I just want to go and watch a good show like this. Because I remember watching Maggie Gorill and Dirk Lombard. Yeah. I wish Susan were here. Do that dance. Yeah. And I like would watch them and I'd be like, oh my God, how is it possible that they could be so beautiful? How is it possible that all of this is happening, that Lenny was so incredible in that Russian song that she, and I just was like, I don't want to be an actress. I want to just be an audience member. I mean, seriously, I was.
You're referring to Lynn Green, by the way, who was so wonderful.
Yes, Lenny Green.
But yeah. It's funny, though, the number of people that came. I remember the one night that when Liza Minnelli showed up in a fur coat that was about the size of the entire zoo. And she sat in a row with the largest fur coat on it. And if you had, you were never more than 3 rows back. And did you know she was going to be in the audience that night?
I can't remember if I knew or I didn't know. I'm hoping that I didn't know because I don't ever really like to know.
Well, you couldn't miss it. But anyway, yeah. There she was. You couldn't miss it.
Right.
But the number of people.
The next night, Peter Allen came. So,
yeah, no, but there was like a parade of people through it. It was a fun experience because the people who saw it and then just the whole experience of doing it.
But then they learned what theater. You know, it was just such an eye opening. I mean, I had never really done it before, really, and I had been on stage, you know, as a ballerina. You know, that's way different than having an audience. Literally, the back row is 10 feet from you.
Yeah, exactly. It was fun. It was a great experience, and you were unbelievable.
And just speaking of collaboration, you know, I think what John said is absolutely true, or you did, Tom, earlier when I was listening in. It was a really beautiful collaboration.
Yeah,
and it set the stage for what I knew is the best way to do anything.
Yeah, that's true. It was time to learn that. It was an important time to learn how to collaborate. Absolutely.
Yeah, and I think maybe we'll learn it again. We'll be reminded over and over again now that nothing is more important than that.
Yeah.
You know, maybe things got in the way, and all of a sudden, because of this thing we're living through, we'll be reminded of the very essence of what's important.
Yeah, in the theater especially, absolutely.
Yeah, and being able to fail, because people have forgotten that it's a process, you know, because we get everything so quickly, and everybody wants immediate satisfaction, and I think we've forgotten somehow that that's...
I've never forgotten how to fail. I've had plenty of reminders in case I can look.
I know.
I just want to mention one thing while we're still on FLORA, that I, as a young producer, learned a lesson from Mr. Kander. He won't remember this. But it was after the first preview. I don't know if you guys remember this. The next day, a couple of songs were cut. There was a ballad called I've Got a Right to Know, a couple of songs. And I called Scott Ellis, the director, and I said, oh my God, I love those songs. Why are we cutting them? And they were like, well, John and Fred felt, you know, they were beautifully sung, but weren't quite working. And he said, you should just give John a call and tell him your opinion. And I was very shy because I never even had like a one-on-one conversation with John. And I called you and told you how much I love those songs and should we just give them a little more time? And you were so kind. You said, well, thank you so much for loving our work. But Fred and I have thought about it and we think that the show is better served without this number or two numbers. So we're going to cut them. And I went, okay. And I thought that was the first time and maybe the last time in my career that a writer was passionate about doing what was best for the show, even if it meant, you know, getting rid of some of their beautiful work. So it was a real moment for me.
Yeah.
I think you always have to put the collaboration up first. And sure, you don't like something gone that you had liked before, but it's perfectly clear that it shouldn't be there. I think that's part of what we learned from Mr. Abbott also. Yeah. It's collaboration.
But Kander, I remember you and Fred said, when you can cut your best work, then you're a professional. And I remember that as like, I always repeat that to myself. It's like, I got to cut it, you know, because otherwise I'm a hack. But it's always comes back to, you can cut your best work, then you can finally think you're a professional. That I think is a hard lesson to be learned, but a good one.
I think what Freddie and I learned early, very early on, and I don't mean it to sound funny, but it's craft. Craft is everything. And that means, as you suggested, sometimes you lose your very best work because your very best work is not going to help the piece survive. That's it. We're carpenters. And the three of us together as we work are always good carpenters. And I think that's what makes our trio collaboration such a joy.
No, it's perfect, and it's a perfect segue to get into more of your collaboration. So, Vianne, thank you.
Love you, Vianne,
for coming by.
This made my I haven't felt this good in a long time. So, thank you guys so much. It was a joy seeing your faces, and I will look forward to the day when we can be together again.
We will be.
Okay. Great. All right. Take care, everybody.
Bye. Bye.
So jumping a bit forward in time, after FLORA the Red Menace, you all and Fred and Scott Ellis collaborated together again on a review of Kander and Ebb's songs and The World Goes Round. And then after that, you all created your first totally original show together, Steel Pier. The Broadway show Steel Pier in 1997, is that right, I think?
Yep.
Set in the world of the 1930s marathon dance craze. And I actually think we have a clip of it that we can show before we start talking about it, just to give people a sense of the feel of Steel Pier.
It's you again.
Still waiting for your partner, huh?
Yes, but I'm sure he'll be here any moment. Thanks for asking.
When you're in trouble, we'll ask, we get 10 times older.
Because if your partner doesn't show, I'm still available.
You'll be the first to know, I promise. Thanks again.
Dance your blues off. Tap bad news off.
Yeah.
Wow. Beautiful. Wow.
That's terrific. So folks, first of all, I want to note, because I don't know if they were all in the clip, that some wonderful performers, some of them got their start, but who had long relationships with all of you, were on that show, from Deborah Monk to Kristen Chenoweth, I think made her debut in that one. Am I right?
Yep.
Yes.
And the lovely Karen Zimba, who then was in our wonderful Kander show with Greg Pierce called Kid Victory. Very briefly, can one of you just tell us how this got started? What led you to the world of dance marathons?
Yes, true. Why don't you talk about that?
Well, I think the thing is, Kander and Neb love dance, and they love when anybody breaks into dance. And I think it was that idea of looking for a show that had a great amount of dance in it. So it was looking for where we could set it, that it still would have some historical importance in America. And it seemed like the dance marathons of the 30s was a great way to begin. And so we started to research that. We got a lot of great research on what they were, the marathons. And there was a dance marathon on the Steel Pier. And people would do this to make money in the Depression. And, it's thought of as a great swell time and so much fun to have people dancing together. But in fact, it was quite cruel that they would make people dance until they dropped. And it seemed very Kander and Neb to do the dark side of some sort of big dance show. And it allowed Tommy to write some wonderful characters and place them in this marathon. People who are struggling, people who are underdogs who want to make it and try to win this contest and pull themselves up out of poverty. So it seems sort of like the perfect location and the perfect thing to do. And I know we had an incredible time putting these dances together and the dance music and the cast was so strong and so collaborative. And the idea too that they all had to learn how to dance. They all had to learn how to dance together. So it made everybody very close. It was a very, very tight cast. Mm-hmm. Tommy?
Well, it was wonderful to work on a project with a clean slate where there was no source material, there was no story. It was about all what you could invent and coming up with ideas and how you toss them back and forth and characters disappeared and characters came forward. And it was a very rewarding time, again, just among all of us to be able to invent. It was just about that power of invention, and it was an incredible company. They were extraordinarily talented, but they were also they just were all very passionate, and a lot of wonderful people were even in that chorus. Casey Nicola and Annie Blankenbuehler were two of Stroh's dancers in that, and of course, went on to stage their own shows so beautifully. So it was really a wonderful experience. I mean, I know that Kander, you have a real soft spot for that show too.
I had a very personal feeling about it, actually, from the very beginning, because the year in which this takes place, during the Depression, my grandparents took me to Atlantic City. I was 6 years old, and we went to the Steel Pier. I can still remember it. The show always felt very personal to me. And I think one of the things about it was all those characters that you mentioned. We had time in the show to get to know them pretty well, and they really stayed with me and all of us. I think if I had, no, I'm about to say something that I may not mean, but I would love to see that piece again. I really missed it. It was one of lots of times. I've done an awful lot of musicals and had a very good time doing most of it. But when it's over, it's over. But Steel Pier, I like to think that it's out there somewhere going on so that I could see it. I want to be with those people again. And that's it. I was about to land in the. It's my favorite piece, but think if I talked about another show, I'd probably forget about that too.
So. I remember going to a preview of it, and I was in the lobby, and all of you guys and Fred and Scott were huddled in a corner, you know, feverishly talking and making changes. And I just was feeling like, oh God, I wish we could grab that group and work on another show at the Vineyard, because it had been, you know, almost a decade. And then a year went by,
and
I get a call from Susan Stroman going, got this really interesting idea for a show that we've been working on. Can we talk to you about it? And it was called The Scottsboro Boys. So I wonder if one of you might tell us a little bit how that subject matter, who were the Scottsboro Boys? How were you drawn to the subject?
Well, a lot of times when you start a musical, it's because somebody hands you a novel or someone hands you a screenplay or something. But we just wanted to work together. So it was more like, let's get together and talk about what we can come up with. And an interesting point came up of what if we did something that was true or something real? Because a lot of times in the musical theater, you're in a more fantastical world. So wouldn't it be nice if we were doing something that was true? So we started to research the Great American Trials. And that, of course, the Scottsboro Boys is one of the most important American trials because it changed history. And when we landed on that, of course, Kander and Neb were so excited about the idea of that. They Kander, and he can tell you, remembers the Scottsboro Boys. And the idea of that kind of writing for the underdog, too, this is what they love to do, you know, maybe this time I'll get lucky, maybe this time I'll win. It's like kind of writing for the underdog, for people with hope. And the idea also of, you know, the Scottsboro Boys were called the Scottsboro Boys like they were a vocal group or something. And it was more important to see these men as individuals.
Could you tell us a little bit about one of who they were? Maybe.
Well, yeah, they were just nine boys.
You want to take that, Tommy?
Yeah, they were just nine boys who didn't know one another, who were out of work. It's 1932. They're on a train. They're heading toward the Mississippi River to get work. And the train has stopped, and everybody is about ready to be thrown off. There was fighting that had been reported on the train, and two girls have been found in the on the train who were about ready to be charged with vagrancy. And instead of being thrown into jail, they accused the nine boys of raping them. So suddenly you have this case, this situation in this very small town, Scottsboro, where posses and a lynching is about ready to happen. And they decided they were going to do the modern thing, which is to try the boys. And then from there, they went into a whole series of trials, each one worse and more circus-like than the next. So that's like the big picture, and a lot of different important things came out of the cases. But the one thing that popped out of it, and I think this became our key to the story, was we read we were having trouble figuring out how to dramatize it. It was so much material. It was so important and so passionately told, but it was such a big story. But we read a reporter of the time saying, in a northern reporter who was filing a story for our newspaper saying, this is like a minstrel show. And suddenly it was like, a minstrel show? Now that's interesting. Because it was a horrible, horrible American art form built on racist tropes and entertainment, but still, it just an intrinsic part of American entertainment as a form to tell the story. And Kander said immediately, well, Kander, you talk about it. I mean, what that minstrel show gave us.
Well, minstrel show was, somebody gave us a number of years, for over 100 years, yeah, the most popular form of theater in the country. And I can remember minstrel shows coming through Kansas City when I was growing up, and they went on and on and on. As a matter of fact, it's in well into the 30s and the 40s, and even after the war. Nobody talked about the fact that blackface was an unbelievable insult to an entire race of people. We thought it was funny. I mean, the country thought it was funny. If you look in lots and lots of movies, you'll see a very sentimental look at minstrel shows and for black people. And then if you think about it, you realize what it really means and what it really does to people. You suddenly feel a sense of shame that you ever found it entertaining. And I think the fact that we used it in the show was a huge help. Scottsboro Boys took a long time to write, as you well remember. We talked about it and talked about it a lot, and wrote it, and then Fred died, and we continued to write it, and it's always in my mind been something which we found. We kept scratching at it, and until it's like you're looking for the truth, and in order to find the truth, you have to scratch away a lot of learned things which are not true. It was, for the three of us, certainly enormously gratifying to get to the point where we thought, yeah, that's true, that's honest. And our wonderful cast was feeling the same thing. I'm not talking coherently, but it was a major experience, certainly in my life and for the three of us.
Well, it's amazing,
if
though.
I can say too that the just that art form allowed us to let the cast create the show in front of the audience's eyes, so they were able to make the minstrel show, to make a jailhouse or a train or a cell with that idea of the 12 chairs or the 13 chairs, and then walk away from it. So although it was taking place in the 30s, the story, it was as if it was a contemporary piece that these actors could walk away from this art form and flip those chairs over and refuse to answer the interlocutor. So it lived in two worlds, you know. Instead of having traditional bentwood chairs, we had very modern chairs, like they looked like they were at the MoMA, you know. So it let the audience know that although this was a story of the 30s, it really resonated today. And I think for the group of guys who did the show, that walking away from that art form at the end was very emotional for them every night, and for me and the audience, and for Tommy and Kander. It never failed to like hit me in the gut every night when that character of Rosa Parks said, I'm not going to move off this bus, you know. So it was a show that'll for all of us, the creation of it and just working and collaborating with that group of actors, and it will always resonate as one of the most important pieces in my life, or most relevant time of my life, really.
But it was incredible, though, I have to say, Doug and Sarah. I mean, it was a piece that if you read the script initially, read down a script, and you go, this is a crazy idea. And I remember Stroh saying, well, what about it? And the fact that you both just said, yeah, let's do it. And there was no pushback. And actually, you were so helpful in helping us find the story we were trying to tell. But I remember your audiences were so incredibly generous too, because it was one of those stories where, you know, you're trying it out in New York. You can't back up. You can't decide not to do something in New York. The first performance has to be the show you're going to be delivering. They're in blackface in that first show, they're in blackface in that first show. You know, if there's something that you're not sure of, you better commit to that in that first show. And that audience, those audiences stayed very, stayed with us through that process. And it was very, made it very possible to keep it moving forward without ever getting frightened or spooked by your own work.
We actually have a little bit of footage from the Scottsboro Boys that we can show. You know, the show started at the Vineyard. It went to Guthrie in Minneapolis. It came to Broadway, where it was nominated for many Tony Awards. It went to London. And I think that the footage we have is from when the Vineyard production was on Broadway. And let's take a look at some of that.
Someone's gonna say, all right, son, take the train and go back home. Ain't a soul can hold me back, cause I am just as free as air. As long as I got legs and train got wheels, I could arrive me anywhere. And if the Lord above comes down and asks you where the hell I am, just tell him no one knows where Hayward goes, cause I'm a box called Baby Lamb.
The men sing in Chattanooga, the men sing in Chattanooga, on the Southern Rim, on the Southern Rim, on the Southern Rim.
Incredible.
Great.
We actually have a special guest, our second special guest from the Scottsboro Boys. He was with us for every part of the journey. Christian Dante White is here.
And we- Hi.
Christian.
Christian.
So good to see you.
Good to see all of you guys and good to see the all the guys in the video and Karen.
Hi, Christian. Hello.
Hi.
So good to see you.
Yeah.
Christian, can you talk a little bit about your experience with the Scottsboro Boys? First and foremost, what it was like to play this real person?
Mm-hmm. Well, you were playing.
Yeah, you were playing.
I did a reading of the show, and I remember when I got the call to audition, I read it. And I was like, I have no idea what this is, but I know this is something epic. And we did the reading and we got to create all these things, and Stro said, you'll be hearing from me. And I was like, I don't know what that means, but okay, thank you. And when I got the call that we were going to do it off Broadway, those weeks were some of the best collaborative moments ever that in my whole career that I can say that I've ever had. Cause we literally created a new musical. And I remember Stro saying how it's a miracle that a new musical can happen. It's a miracle that we can be here to do this. And I learned how to be in a room. I learned how, it was not me. Other actors were doing other dances from Stroh's. And I remember Stroh saying, I need everyone to be in the room. You can't be doing Dreamgirls choreography. I need you to be here as we create this thing. And I learned how to watch other actors. I was learning from Coleman Domingo and Forrest McClendon and learning from Sharon Washington and watching Sharon walk with poetry in her body was incredible. And John Kander tapping me on the shoulder and said, that line will be perfect if you just slow down just that much. So it was the best education possible. And then learning how to fake tap dance on a Susan Stroman musical. I still sweat thinking about it. But the room was just set up for great art. It was set up to, like Kander was saying, every why not deserves to be heard. And every time I came to Stroh with anything, it was always welcomed. It was always, let's see if there's anything in that or try it out. Why not? And I remember anytime I would try something, I would come through, is that okay? And one time she just said, I will let you know when it's not good. You just keep going. So I don't take any of that lightly because it's not every show you get to be as collaborative as we were in the show. Not only that, to assemble a group of Black men to tell such a historic story and the bond that we created in that cast is just something I'll never forget. And that's why the show was so rich and so grounded because they set a room up to create and to be together and assemble. So it's you know, I can't talk enough about that process. It was really special, really special.
What was your experience?
You were really special in it, I'm sorry.
Thank you. Thank you.
Truly.
And what was your experience of the minstrel form? Stroh and Kander spoke so eloquently about it. And from your perspective, you know, being inside and performing, what was your experience of that?
It wasn't easy, and I applaud the whole creative team. The whole time they were so delicate with us and prepared and set up a room for us to all feel safe and not force anything upon us. I remember we did a whole makeup tutorial about it. I remember we talked about it before we did it. It also really helped in this difficult form that I didn't feel alone. I had my other cast members there all going through the same thing at once. And I knew it was very important for all of us to tell this story and give them life in the best way possible. So we needed to be as brave as they were back then. And we always were very aligned with not making this a story about victims, that they were heroes because we went through this whole story. So it was very important to lean on my other brothers, but it was always difficult, but perfectly timed out and perfectly in place to end that story the way that we did. So I applaud them for their bravery too, because I'm sure there was some type of, should we do this or should we not? But it was the perfect way to end telling that story. But it was not easy. Doing the whole show is not easy. There was no phoning it in. There was no, you have to give it complete, you know, self to this whole show. There was no water breaks really. And Stroh made us in tip top form shape and, you know, taking care of our bodies mentally, like it, but the show needed that. You can't do this show and phone it in. And also, Adrienne Warren said this about playing Tina Turner on Broadway. She said, as much as my body hurts, as much how tired I am doing 8 shows a week, I'm lucky that I only have to play her on stage. I didn't have to live through this. So if I got to give all I have to this show, I'll get all that I have. And that's exactly how we felt. And I thought she put it eloquently, so perfectly before, but we didn't have, this could have been us, you know, back in the early 1900s. It was our job as actors to tell their story. And we all took that very seriously every single night, every single rehearsal, every single page turn, every single new line, new music notes, everything. So we felt a huge responsibility. And that's what took the show from being great to, I think, a great work of art.
Yeah, it was It's amazing though, in the whole process. You're so right. Everybody in that cast just grabbed whatever they were given, and there was never a rehearsal or even a, sometimes in rehearsals, nothing ever happens until 5, 10 minutes to five. You know, it's the last 10 minutes when everything actually gets finished. But that, those weeks of rehearsing, I've never seen it, an entire room full of people pulling more toward the goal that was set for that day, whatever it was, whatever that number would be. And, and that made it, that entire rehearsal process so extraordinary. It was a remarkable time.
I couldn't wait to get to rehearsal. I was so excited just to create. I felt like a real artist. Even when we started teching and previewing at the Vineyard Theater, I felt like this is art. This is special. It wasn't commercial theater. It wasn't just song and dance, be happy, go home. Like this was meaningful. And I always call Scottsboro Boys, I call it high art. It's not just normal, you know, shake and bake Broadway. I always say that it's high art. And yeah, I agree.
I'm going to bring up something which I don't think we were going to plan to talk about, but and why didn't we make it? Why did we not get our audience?
That's a good question. I don't know. Christian, what do you think?
You know, I, because I did a show Off-Broadway. I went to the Guthrie. I went to Broadway. I did in LA. And then I did London the first time. And they all were about 3-month increments. And I said, I thought about it one day. And I was like, you know what? I don't know if I could have done this show for a year because it takes so much out of you. And I think that for whatever reason, it needed to be in those increments for that amount of time to touch the people it needed to touch. And then we moved on to a next incarnation and to a new cast, to a new area of people that needed to see the show. So, you know, for that time in that place, it just needed to be in those small increments for whatever reason. And but I disagree. I think we did reach so many people, and I, every single show that I've done, Scottsboro Boys is always a show everyone mentions, like every other night at the stage door or coming up to me, and you know, when I'm in the theater district. So it was one of those, you just had to be there to experience it, and it was so special. That's why I still call it, you know, high art. But I don't know what a year run of Scottsboro Boys at that time would have been. Now maybe differently, but you know, I think everything happens for a purpose and for a reason. So
yeah, I just want to add, answer. Christian, I just want to add that, you know, from my perspective, and to John, it was a singular and one of the most successful experiences I've ever had in the theater, and certainly at the Vineyard, both creatively, it was so fulfilling. And it really did well at our theater, let's even besides, you know, how we all felt about it. Granted, the Vineyard's a smaller house with a limited run, but it was very well received, very well attended, and it created a lot of excitement and a lot of conversation. Why certain shows of that caliber don't do as well in the commercial theater, you know, that we could do a whole story on that. But I was really delighted in researching this today. I was going to YouTube, and I was surprised at how many productions there are. There's even a high school production right now, right?
Yeah.
So I'm hopeful that as a creative experience, it will go on and be seen and have resonance with people.
Yeah, I have no doubt that that will happen. And in a funny way, I agree that it was probably better as a short run because it needed to be that powerful burst that it was.
Yeah.
It just popped. And then to try and sustain that over a year as a commercial production, I don't know if that would necessarily have been the assignment. I loved what we did.
We have a comment that I think is apropos from our friend Coleman Domingo. Like, we were a supernova.
Oh my gosh, Coleman Domingo.
Coleman Domingo, our fearless leader.
Gosh. Absolutely. Love Coleman.
Christian, like you, we hear so often from people who the show touched so immensely. And, you know, we all had the experience too of, you know, in 2013, I think it was, where the governor of Alabama then passed official legislation exonerating the Scottsboro Boys and credited the renewed attention that the musical brought to the case as part of how that came to happen. And that was quite an extraordinary moment too.
Yeah.
Huge impact.
I think the show I mean, in the first place, like the rest of us here, it was a very, very, very fulfilling experience. I'm very proud of it. I think I've always been a little curious. New York was, the show has been more successful popularly everywhere else but New York. I don't know if I'm telling the truth about that or not, but it seems to me that everywhere we went doing it again, it became an event. In New York, there was a kind of, I don't know. It was,
but that wasn't true at the Vineyard, not at the Vineyard. It was a huge success at the Vineyard and a huge success for them artistically and financially. It just, that Broadway run was short, that's all. But everywhere else, you know. And it won the best musical in London.
How did we do critically? I don't remember.
We did generally well.
Well, everyone loved me, John. That's all that matters. Everyone loved my performance, John.
That was an innocent question. I really don't remember.
The reviews were largely quite supportive and positive at the Vineyard, really, with one or two questions. But I felt they were 80 to 90% favorable. And that was my memory of it.
Also, what we did was unheard of. We were doing a minstrel show with all these Black men with an all-white creative team. Like, this was crazy talk to everyone who saw, it was one of those things everyone was walking and going, like, what is this before they actually experienced it? And it's not a show you see, it's a show you experience,
That's right.
So we were all doing crazy what in the world are we doing type things back then. So the fact that, again, it's a miracle that we even got on a New York stage considering what we were trying to do. And not only that, and I will go on record saying doing the show at the Vineyard was my favorite incarnation of that show out of all the 18 productions I did. Being right there at the Vineyard, it was just perfect. This theater space and everything was just so perfect about that production. And but yeah, what we were doing was unheard of. It was very brave on all fronts.
Yeah. The Vineyard, though, was great, though, because, man, I remember that the people in that front row could not have been closer to you.
And oh, my God. We were spitting on them.
They were, like, terrified. You could see them. There you go. Look at that comment. At one point, the sheriff's badge fell from the stage and landed at my feet. Yes.
Yeah. Stroman, there's something I've never asked you, and I've always had in my head. What your physical conception of that show was just fucking brilliant. And when, at what point in the process did the chairs appear in your head? Because
right away with the once we landed on the minstrel art form, that was always done with 13 chairs and an interlocutor and the end-mend. And so that's how it started. But what was wonderful about it, it allowed the actors to take over in a way, because that they would have always told a story in a minstrel show, but it would have been about, the farmer's daughter and the well-hung stable boy or something. But, here these guys now could take a story and tell a true story that made the interlocutor, the big white man, like, going, what's going on? I don't know. Understand what the story they're telling, and tell a story for real that would have never been told in a minstrel show, but that it's almost like they connived to tell this story to the audience and then be able to walk away from the art form. But the chairs allowed me to not have any other set, to work with Beowulf Borat, our set designer, on how to make a train and a holding cell, but it ultimately. It was perceived by the audience as if the young men took over the show.
And that was quite a...
That was the right perception.
Yeah.
Yeah, Christian, talk about those chairs, though, because that was math.
I was just going to say that, that also built a trust within the cast. I mean, we had to depend on each other for every peg, every chair. If that person... I studied the people around me, so if they messed up, I was able to get there. That also was another glue to the cast with that chairography. And I don't know how anyone swung that show, but it just added another layer of, we really have to do this together, and really built a team, almost like a sports team almost. But yeah, when we were in sync and together, there was just no stopping us. There was just another layer of, we're all in this together as a true ensemble piece.
It's funny. I remember one performance, for whatever reason, the chairs had gotten out of order. And I looked up and I thought, those chairs are out of order. The next move, nobody's going to be in the right place. And then suddenly all of you, while the action's going on, just started moving the chairs into the right space and setting it up for the next move. Nobody in the audience knew it, but you're so right. It was like there was like this dialogue going on, unspoken. Yep. We need to fix the situation, and we need to do it now. Yeah, it was great. Yeah. It was great to watch. Yeah.
Scottsboro Boys was truly a show that pushed things forward. It really was, and an extraordinary experience that we were so proud to work on. And Christian, thank you so much for coming by to talk to us.
Thanks for having me. It's a true honor. Seriously, thank you.
I love you.
Thank you. Love you guys.
Bye, honey. Bye.
Bye.
We're going to jump ahead. We should have done this in two parts. If we'd been thinking, we would have done a two or three parter with this. But let's jump ahead to your most recent collaboration at the Vineyard, The Beast in the Jungle. Such a unique piece, truly a dance play, a new form for all of you. Can you talk a little bit about how The Beast in the Jungle came to be?
Strong.
Well, that was another example of wanting to be together and what to create and to sit around and talk about ideas. And the idea about a man who has lived his whole life and didn't connect with anybody and didn't... He lost his life by not reaching out, and there was the love of his life there, and he was too afraid to go for it, and of course we know people like that, and basing it on the novel, the novella Beast in the Jungle, and bringing it up to date, it seemed like the right idea for us because it was very poetic. And the thought of doing a piece that had dance and narration in it, and for Kander, that idea of writing in three-quarter time, writing in waltzes. And I know at the very beginning, every day I would get a new waltz from John Kander on my cell phone. And the idea that my phone would ring and it would be a new waltz from John Kander, because it's that idea of time and also it's a very hypnotic feel, three-quarter time, to go through the entire evening. So it sort of hypnotizes the audience. But Tommy, you talk about the writing of it.
Well, it was a wonderful process because we were working in a form that we didn't know. So that's always a good place to start. And it was about taking a story that would be told in language, but then it wouldn't speak anymore, it would then be told in movement, and the movement would take over very seamlessly. So you're constantly switching up how you're telling a story. You're not singing, nobody breaks into song, but you keep moving from the spoken word to a danced form, but it's all in the same language, it's all the same characters. And it was a wonderful process because none of us really knew, could really point to a form like this. It wasn't like we could say, well, this is a little bit like that. It wasn't. And for that reason, it was always very, the discovery was always so rewarding of what you can do if you just decide to break the form and just bust it up. And Kander, you were always very certain that we weren't going the wrong way, but it was very, very rewarding.
I think that one of the great, great joys of our collaboration and why we keep coming back to it is we've never done anything we knew how to do. Truly. I think the excitement of that, it's like the three of us basically saying, I don't know how to do it. Let's do it.
Let's do it.
Yeah. And so each piece that we've done together has been kind of mysterious, exciting, slightly scary adventure. It's the same with what we're doing now and would continue to do. I think we're just lucky as hell. No, I mean it. we get together a lot, and we when we're working on our project, and we talk a lot, and it's what if all the time, and usually ending with a, I don't know, maybe it's all right. I don't think that we bore each other.
No,
we were very lucky to take a piece like Beast in the Jungle because it was unique in its form of dance and narration and three-quarter time, and for the Vineyard to produce it for Doug and Sarah to produce it and give us that opportunity, because it ended up to be so beautiful. It was just so Michael beautiful. Curry did a beautiful set, and David Loud's musical direction and Sam Davis's arrangements. That it just was just like this musical bubble, and it was so beautiful on your stage. Yeah, I'll never forget what it looked like. Those images really stick in my mind.
I want to agree. I think about it all the time, actually. I think about it all the time. The beauty of it, the daring of it, the passion. Stro, the way you took this group of dancers, and they were acting with such conviction and ferocity and power. Every single one of them, all the women in the forest, Tony and Irina, who were magnificent. And it really went to a dark and I thought quite profound place. And it was like this strange, wonderful fever dream, the whole show.
Yeah.
And I think about it, and you know, you do a lot of shows for the years, and it's one that sticks with me. And you know, John was talking about what if. This was also a what is it? This was a what are we creating here? It was completely new and fresh, and it was just a joy. And like with Scottsboro Boys, I want to add this too, and this speaks to all three of you. The company bonded in a way that they became this unit that lasted beyond the run of the show at the Vineyard. I remember getting, you know, we had this wonderful chorus of women dancing like a tarantella, and then they all went to Italy together and they danced in Italy in front of a villa and sent us the YouTube of it doing a set, which was so extraordinary. But that just speaks so well to the spirit in the room, both in the rehearsal room and on our stage, Stro, that you bring to it, and you bring to it, John and Tommy. It's something that changes people who work with you.
Thank you.
That was an extraordinary cast. Tony Yazbek and Irina Dvorenko and Peter Friedman. I mean, a fantastic cast. Yeah. Extraordinary.
We actually have some footage, a short montage of Beast in the Jungle too, so people will get to see a little bit of what we're talking about when we talk about the original unusual form and the beauty of the show.
And this is set to the beautiful prelude that John Kander wrote, sort of the overture, with interesting montage of moments from it. So let's take a look at it now.
Thank you.
All right. So beautiful. Let's talk very briefly about what's next for you. I know we might not be able to talk about any specific project, but we can say they're all working together on something new, and that even in this quarantine time, you have been working together. You've been collaborating. What is that like?
It's weird.
So, we're Wednesday at 11 o'clock. Yeah. And for like 2 or 3 hours. And we've created this new piece. And it's been going great. Even in quarantine, it's been going surprisingly well. We're meeting. And like Kander said before, we talk about what this story could be. And now we've started to really add the music to it. And it's going very well. And I'm feeling very good about it. So hopefully when we get on the other side of this apocalypse, we'll have a new musical.
It's been fun to work on. Like, we started it probably maybe in September or so. So we were well into it by the time we got to the world closing down and everybody having to pull up the stakes and move back to where they're, you know, where they were all going to start to live in their caves. But it's been a great experience because we were at a place where we could continue the work, be really clear about what we needed to do, and then just work and just do the work and just have the conversations and do it. You know, the fact that we're all on Zoom or on telephone calls isn't a hindrance. You know,
at this point it has not been. Tommy and I both shaved before the meeting.
Yeah. Stro won't let us show up to a Zoom call with a beard, so we have to clean up.
She's very exacted.
They have to clean up. They can't show up in their pajamas or anything.
No beard,
nice,
no
clean
nothing.
Collaborators all the time.
I do want to say something about, and it sounds like almost a commercial, but I mean it from my whole heart. The experiences that I've had at the Vineyard, and I've had a lot, it defines for me as a theatrical home, the place to go when you have an idea and you don't know what the fuck to do about it, but you've got to write it and they're going to let you. Supply some safety and some really, really, really thoughtful feedback. You guys are better than anybody at looking at work and then without stating it stating your opinions in a castrating way, really giving us something to work with and to work on. And I've been working there for a long time now, and it's what I value most about the experience. And I hope to be back there.
Yeah, I mean, the Vineyard allowed me to do my first play with Coleman Domingo and a wonderful play called Dot, and Sharon Washington. You know, it was like the extension of the Scottsboro family, and I loved doing it, and because of that I've been able to do some other plays, so the opportunities for people to really create there and take chances. And I think that's what the Vineyard needs to be celebrated about. It allows artists to take chances, and a lot of other institutions don't. But the Vineyard will not only let you take a chance, but support you and be there for you, and not only dramaturgically, but just spiritually and for your soul, be there to help you through. So there's no place like the Vineyard. You know, yeah. I mean, I'll be forever grateful that we knocked on your door 30 years ago.
It's so true. I mean, listen, there's no, the ability to take a risk in New York is gone. You know, people don't want to see risks. They don't want to know from risks. It's audiences, it's funding, it's critics. It's just the way people want to view you. But the problem is, if you don't take a risk, you end up doing the same thing over and over again. And it's a real wonderful thing to know that those risks still live in New York, in the Vineyard. And it's feeling like you're given that safety where you feel like you're out of town. You aren't out of town, but nobody's ever at the front door breathing down your neck about a choice you're making. And that's rare. It's in New York. I mean, I have to say, Doug, just the fact that you've been with the theater, that you've been with the theater since we've been there. I don't think there are any regional theaters in New York, nonprofit theaters in New York, that have that kind of longevity with an artistic director at the helm. And then Sarah, you coming in and picking up the helm as well. There's not that sense of continuity. And that makes a big difference. You know, there's no.
Thank you so much. And, you know, it goes back to you. We adore working with all three of you. It's such a special and beautiful experience. There's no happier question when the phone rings and one of you says, "Hey, we have something new to show you." John Kander says, "Is it okay if I play in your basement?" I believe we have some questions there.
Thank you. I'll just echo Doug that thank you all for trusting us to work with you. It is truly, I know I speak for both of us, one of the great highlights of our life to collaborate with you. We do have some questions coming in from Facebook, so we'll just take a couple because we're a little bit over time. Abby on Facebook has a question for Stro, and she says, "What advice would you give to a young choreographer?" And she adds, "I think your work is amazing."
The best thing for a young choreographer is to try to be in the room and observe someone who's really in the trenches of a new musical or a new dance piece. I mean, whether you're a choreographer for a company or want to do the theater, you know, my union, the SDC, has a wonderful thing called an observership and also a fellowship. So calling the SDC and giving your information and resume to them, and then they match you up with different directors and choreographers so you can actually observe and be in the trenches with them. And I have to say, for the last 25 years, on every single show I've ever done, I have an observer, and they've gone on to do great things. So I would push yourself to learn more, always learn more, and to observe and be in the room.
Yeah.
John, there's a question for you, and I think you're going to consider it a very hard question. Katie on Facebook wants to know, what was your favorite show to work on and why?
Whoa.
Who's that for, Kander?
For Kander.
I could not give a truthful answer because I've been lucky enough to have wonderful experiences that I did not want to leave. I can say that one of my most wonderful afternoons in my life in the theater was the final run through Steel Pier in the rehearsal room. It was an afternoon where if I ever had any doubts about how I wanted to spend my life, they vanished then. Things went on and this often happens to me, as a matter of fact. The rehearsal room is a magical place. Everything is possible. After that, for me, it's interesting, but it's a different experience. But that afternoon with those people and everything coming together really kind of for the first time was an experience I'll never forget.
Yeah.
There's one final question from Kat on Facebook, and it's for all of you. Do you have tips for artists who are trying to collaborate in this new virtual world that we're in?
Stro, take that one.
The thing is, if you believe in your art and you believe you have something there, you have to sort it out. You know, like you have to, in this quarantine time, whatever your art is, if you're a performer, you still need to work on your craft. You still need to be singing and dancing. You know, I have friends who take dance class every day and people reaching out for vocal lessons. And as far as collaborating, if you have an idea, call up your friend who's a composer and toss ideas around. And because you know what, the phone's not going to ring. The phone never rings. You have to you have to make it happen. And you can make it happen out of a quarantine and inside a quarantine. You know, the thing is, you just have to keep working on your art. You know, you can't let a pandemic take you down. A pandemic can't stop your creative juices from flowing. So you have to keep going. And I would say if you are creating something or have an idea, then start getting some collaborators together and toss some ideas around. And this is a perfect time to do that.
Well said. Well said.
Listen, everybody, this has been an amazing opportunity to catch up with you and converse. And I know I speak for Sarah when I just say you are three beautiful collaborators. We just adore working with you. Each experience we've done in different ways has been special, enlightening, fresh, and exciting for us and new. And we just can't wait to do the next one. So hopefully we'll able to work together again. And we really thank you all.
Have an idea, Doug. We're going to call you.
Okay.
Yeah. Hey. Amen.
Thank you.
Okay. Love you thank guys you. So much.
Thank you so much. Love you.
Thank you.
Thank you so much for being here with us. Join us next week when Brandon Victor Dixon, who actually starred in the Scottsboro Boys at the Vineyard, will be here with us to talk about his career in the theater and making music. We hope you'll come back. Till then, stay safe and be well.
Bye-bye.
Thank you for tuning in to The VT Show, brought to you live every Tuesday at 5 p.m. If you would like to view previous episodes, you can find them on Facebook and YouTube. See you next week.